yeah.
You too.
And how are things?
Good. We finished touring for 2.5 years now. And
show off.
Finally got the time to write a new album, you know, which has been cool. So we just finished doing about 25 demos for new songs.
Nice.
And, now we're just waiting for the approval from the almighty label.
Yeah.
Whether or not we're good enough to go and make an album.
Well, I think 500,000 records in America says that you are, so.
Well, you know, you would think so, but sometimes that's not enough.
Really?
We have to go in and, because, you know, they have projected visions of what's going to happen, and then if it doesn't happen the way they want it to happen, then it's a failure.
Mm-hmm, true, yeah, and I mean, it's a different ballgame, isn't it?
Yeah, just when
you think you've figured it all out, then somebody comes along and changes all the rules.
Well, just when you think you deserve at least a pat on the back, you don't get one.
Yeah, that would be nice, yeah.
And instead you get faced with, well, we don't really, you know, should have done this. And
Yeah, I mean, you know, comparative, I think, you know, again, I think the problem that you sit with is that, you know, you're a band that has no history, well, no, I don't think there is any band in the history of, certainly of modern rock, in the American eyes, that they can actually compare, you know, a band like Seether to. You know, it's not like there was a band, you know, a South African band that went to America, did what you did, that knocked the lights out completely, that they could turn around and say, well, hey, compared to that, you are the benchmark.
which definitely makes it tougher, because there's no standard. We're the ones pretty much setting that standard for anyone else.
Yeah, yeah.
Look at Seether, yeah.
We are Seether, hold on, yeah. Yeah, I think in a way, I mean, I'm sure now you can understand why so many bands, I think certainly in North America, you know, can have a very successful career without the aid of a label, you know, and that frustration, because, I mean, you know, hypothetically, now you're in a position where you can do that.
Yeah, you know, bands that aren't signed sell 100,000 or 200,000 albums, that's successful.
Mm.
But if you get signed, it now appears that if you don't sell 1 million, it's not successful.
Yeah.
That's the weird part, because, you know, like, say for instance, South Africa selling 5,000,
sure,
huge deal. It's nowhere near gold, but, you know, for the signed bands, that's not good enough. The point of reference obviously changes depending on how much money you put into the project.
Sure, and I think in Wind-Up's case, there was a lot of setup, but I don't believe, you know, for a minute that if any label, especially a label like Wind-Up, based on what they had said to you when you initially signed to them, was this was for the long haul. You know, they didn't expect everything to happen, you know, with Seether, you know, on album one. I mean, album one was, if anything, it was for you to get, you know, just to find your feet. And I mean, on that basis alone, you've done that, and you've actually made some money for the label, which.
Well, the thing is that, you know, we've made money for the label, and it's a way of introducing yourself to the world, so to speak. But you know, mostly the stuff on that album was, you know, 8-9 years old. That definitely was. You know, now we're going to do something that's from the past 2 years. It's creatively come from there. So that's going to definitely be a different sounding album, and a hopefully, you know, a more mature one. But you know, it's just that the thing that freaks me out, though, is that, you know, that there is a. I mean, I know it's mostly mind games that I play, because it's a question of, well, we really love what they've got now, but we want to see if they can come up with anything better. So we can tell them we don't like what they have.
You know? True.
And that's a game that we played on the first album.
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
You know, it's not any less frustrating for them. If you know that there's a game being played.
Exactly. Yeah, well, they are the, you know, you are the puppet and they are the puppet master, so.
Well, that's definitely influenced the writing of the new stuff, you know.
Yeah, which I think will be interesting, because, I mean, you know, as you say, you're going to give them the demos. Peter was telling me that you're heading off to Europe, in a couple of weeks' time, which I think, you know, this is going to be your first headlining tour.
Yeah.
And it's going to be very, very interesting to see on the back of that what they have to say, because I think my gut tells me that that's going to be a phenomenal tour for you. And the kind of feedback that they are not going to be able to ignore, that coupled with the fact that, you know, once they listen back to the demos, I think, as you say, because those demos come out of the last 2 years, that comes out of the entire North American experience.
Yeah. Well, you know, they're great. They've been really good to us. And so I'm not ever going to say anything.
No, that's not the point.
But the point is, the thing is, there is a time when personally I go, wow, you know, I figure that, you know, we've now given you 25 songs. We're now about to go on, you know, we've gone gold in Canada and Australia and New Zealand and now almost in Germany. So, yeah, things are happening and everyone's freaking out except for the people that we should trust the most. The people that should be behind us the most.
As you say, don't you think because it's a case of mind games of the conversation that they have with you and the conversation that they have amongst themselves when you're not there are two very different conversations.
Yeah, totally. But that's also just my assumption.
Yes.
You know what I mean? So it might be that I'm going, well, it's just mind games, and then in the back of the other.
They're pushing you. Yeah, they're pushing you to be better than you already are. let it be that.
Sometimes it's like a parenting thing almost. You know? It's like, you know, you don't turn to your kid and say, man, you're useless, you don't know what you're doing. You're that's awesome, but I know you can be better.
Yeah.
That's not what I'm getting.
Yeah.
You know, I'm getting the bad parenting spiel of, hey, you know, well, it's not really, there's about one song we can use, so, you know, why don't you go back in and try and write some more for us?
Yeah.
It's like, that part of it made me particularly.
Sure.
Unhappy because they're telling me that the only thing I personally think that I know how to do, they're telling me I don't know how to do anymore.
Exactly.
So that's kind of personally, it's a hell of a deal, a hell of a thing to deal
with. To deal with, absolutely, yeah, because you're going, you accepted, you know, what was the pretext for accepting the initial songs? Was that sort of like, well, we'll humor those because, you know, we're looking at the, you know, at what's going to come out of stuff down the road. I don't believe that for a second because, again, 500,000, you know, Americans think differently. You know, gold records in like four territories tells you differently.
Well, you know, basically what they did before was we came off the road, we were supposed to do an album, and we did one. We basically wrote one, but it was a couple of old songs that we could rehash, but it was all new stuff. I think the main thing was that at the heart of it all, they thought that the album was a disappointment, so they wanted to try and maximize the potential of the album, and therefore they did the resulting trick where we had to put the new version of the song on the album and re-release the thing. That kind of, with a complete disregard for our fans, our credibility, how our fans see us, you know, what that means as far as our longevity.
Yeah.
You know, I think personally, I just think that it was a decision based on how much can we get out of this, how much, you know.
But then,
with complete disregard for that.
But in a way, it seems to be indicative of the label as a whole, because if you take a situation like, you know, with Evanescence, I mean, now that the live DVD that's, you know, coming out and the live album, you know, in a way, if you compare Disclaimer 2 and that, in a way, they're doing the same thing with that.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, you know, it's, I think, and rightfully so, they're a little worried because all the new bands they've signed aren't selling any albums. They've got a stable now of 16 bands, and of those bands, you'll probably know of four. And of those four, one broke up. Drowning Pool hasn't been doing very well.
No.
They could sell the name, which I don't think was a good idea at all.
No.
And they've got Evanescence. So basically, they have us and Evanescence for next year.
Yeah.
I almost don't understand why there's this wall we're encountering.
Yeah. Yeah, they should be doing everything in their power to nurture that which they have, yeah.
You'd figure that. But hey, I'm no psychologist.
But you see, What I'm appreciating about this whole thing is that when you know what I mean, and we really did speak a good 12 months ago, to the place that you are now, and I mean this with all due respect, you were in the thick of it at that stage, and you had already at that point learned so many lessons. Now you're in a place where you are a completely different person because of what you've been put through, but stronger for it. You know, unfortunately, you know, because of this crap, you become better at what you do because you just pain. Well, you're living it. You're living it. So, you know.
It's also. I get emails from these little kids all the time saying, you know, we've sold out and you know this and that, and I write back saying, look, man, if you knew anything that goes on, if you knew even the smallest, I hope your band gets signed. And I hope your band gets to go through this, because then you would understand that it's not, you know, once you get signed, 99% of the decisions that are made are probably not yours.
Yes.
Unless you earn the right, you have to earn that right, and then you have to earn that, I guess, that privilege from them. Because that's the way labels work.
Yeah, but I mean, the really sad thing of all is that, you know, no matter who the band is, I mean, your right to speak is ultimately dictated by the amount of, you know, the number of dollars that you generate, not necessarily your credibility, and that's where the longevity aspect goes out the window, because it has nothing to do with artistic ability. It has to do with, you know, what the market, you know, the fickle market that you play to is up for. And it's a dangerous, you know, line to, you know, to walk.
For any band, their goal is to be around for 10, 15, 20 years.
Sure, this is your life, yeah.
Yeah, now on the corporate side of it, you have, well, you know, they might only be around for 2 or 3 years, so let's try and, you know, get as much out as we can.
Yeah, right?
And that's where the biggest clash comes in thinking between bands and their labels.
But you see, this is a classic opportunity for you, I suppose, as a band, to turn around and go, you know what, actually, fuck it. I don't need it. You know, I can do this another way. But then they've won, haven't they? And to the detriment of your fans, ultimately.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. That's why, you know, that disclaimer two thing was really tough for me. Because I had to try and add as much new stuff. You know, it was just, I really was freaking out.
Yeah, because you were aware of who you were, who this was going to and who this was being pitched at.
The people just like me.
Yeah.
And that's what they fail to understand time and time again, is that being, you know, just because you're in a band doesn't make you automatically a moron. Guys that are in bands are the guys that go out and buy CDs because they love bands.
Sure.
Not the guys that get the CDs for free every week in a big shipment from the record company.
Exactly. And even more so now with, I mean, and again, the argument is even stronger on the basis that, you know, burning and every other kind of, you know, counterfeiting that is happening is so rife. I mean, you want to give them every reason not to, you know, do that.
Yeah, and because, I mean, with prices being what they are, it's understandable that their kids spending that much money get as much as they can. And if you give it to them, they won't mind going out and buying it. Now they're suddenly, because Hollywood is now being threatened by the downloading thing, they have now jumped on the bandwagon.
Yeah.
You can now burn and download full movies online, and that's freaking Hollywood out.
And yeah.
You know, now that you've got the big machine is now, you know, being threatened. Multi-billion-dollar industry is now being threatened. Now there's a huge, you know, now you get FBI warnings on TV. Illegal pirate stuff. So.
But you see, I mean, the thing is that it's quite funny that, you know, the bands have been aware of it for longer than, I think the labels have been aware of it, but they haven't done anything, you know, they've chosen not to do anything about it. And again, focus their energies in the wrong places. Like, as I say, they're friends and they're artists, and the things that they own, instead of nurturing those things, they're alienating them and again, not serving their own business, ultimately.
Yeah.
It's weird, okay. Yeah.
When your existence is such a small, self-built universe, it's difficult to see what's beyond it. You know?
Sure. And it's interesting, too. I mean, the thing is that wind up, like, I think probably, you know, comparative to a label like Roadrunner, you know, 20 years ago, certainly didn't exist, you know, in any, you know, form, and to the point that, yeah, they've become, because of the bands that they've signed, have become major players. And
well, yeah, they're basically, I think they're the largest independent in the world now.
Yeah.
Cool. But the thing is, I mean, to give them credit where it's due, they've had numerous tests, like Finger 11, as being the one question, or the one example of question. I mean, they had an album come out about 6 years ago, and it did nothing in the States.
Yeah.
But it went gold in Canada.
Yeah.
So then they had another album come out, and that did nothing in the States, but it went gold in Canada. And yeah. now they're on their third album, and the label never dropped it.
Yeah.
They always stuck with it and tried to, and like they say, develop the career of it.
Yeah.
But sometimes it's difficult to remember it.
But you see, I think the problem in your case is that you sold enough for them to be interested enough in what they perceived to be your, you know, what you delivered and what your true potential was. I think if you had sold 100,000 copies, they probably would have been okay with that.
Yeah, it's kind of a curse.
Yeah.
You have to do that.
Exactly. Damned if you do and damned if you don't. Yeah.
Exactly.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Good time.
Yeah, hey, rock on. So the show that you're going to be taking to Europe is that going to be pretty much what the North American audiences have seen, or are you going to be test driving some of those new songs?
We've actually stopped playing the new ones because the new ones are now coming up online and replay.
Shit! How do they compare to the tracks on Disclaimer? Are they like leaps and bounds, or?
I think so. Yeah. There's a couple of songs that are still fairly close to that sound and that kind of style. But there's definitely been. We have another guitarist now this year. And
yes.
He's a really really interesting solo player. At least he's been playing some awesome leads that we never used to have that in our music. So that's one aspect that's grown better. And in general, I would say it's just been. I definitely think it's more interesting musically because, when we started playing, we could hardly play our guitars, and now we have a little bit. I mean, I still play like cuck, but I play like cuck a little better than I used to.
Exactly. you found a way around that.
So, now I can play like cuck less convincingly. I don't know.
But no, you get away with it now.
Yeah. Now people can't call me on it. It's definitely, I think. Sonically more interesting to listen. I really concentrate a lot more on melodies this time, and I think I think just everything is a lot more mature because, a song, for instance, like 69T, I wrote when I was just 15 or 16 years old.
Yeah.
Now I'm 25, and the stuff I write now is completely different to that. So
that
in its own is a big factor.
I mean, what in your mind, when you look back on, certainly on the last two years, was the biggest driver, the biggest influence in the way that you did things and the way that you do things now?
I don't know. I think the stuff that's influenced me as far as writing and has driven me to do that has been just general injustices to the little guy.
Mm.
I think anything that's aimed towards the underdog because, there's just so much injustice that it's... Especially, when you just look around, and you're not just 16 years old and self-absorbed. You're actually, you're an adult looking around and you're seeing what's going on around.
Yeah, and you're actually competing in the real world too.
Yeah, and you go, man, it's pretty fucked up.
So
I think that definitely had a part to play, and a couple here and there, really profound experiences that I've had with people that have been, just either really really. Mortifying experiences, but in general, it's just been basically focusing on, the whole idea that just watching, the cool kids pick on the uncool kids. And well, you like Bush, well then you're a faggot. And if you don't like Bush, then you're a redneck.
Yeah. It's interesting, isn't it? I mean, the same rules apply no matter where you are and no matter what place you hold in the world, regardless of your status or where you live or what car you drive.
Yeah. That's the thing is that the country needs both sides.
For sure.
If it didn't have both sides, it would just be, a dictatorship. So,
yeah.
But that's one. And then, like the whole thing that just happened with George Bush outlawing gay marriage. I was outraged. He makes it a constitution that a marriage will only be between a man and a woman.
Because he says that.
My tour manager and probably best friend on the road is a gay guy.
Yeah.
And he's obviously...
He's affected by that, yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, he can't go get married because the president is going for the redneck vote. And
yeah.
The redneck really is, you know, the majority of the country.
The bread and butter of American, yeah. It is scary when you think about it, isn't it?
Well, what's really scary is that he might re-win the election.
Yes, scarier still.
Having been to Europe before and after this guy was president, you see the change in the way people think about American people is not right.
No.
It's gone from, yeah, they're cool people, but now it's like people just refuse to even be nice to them.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, what I'm sensing here is that, you know, I figure sort of 10 years from now, we'll have a conversation and you'll be actually sort of running for governor of California.
No. I need to have that. No, I'm not a politician. I can just see, you know, I'm just offended by the lack of respect that the people get, for one.
Sure. Because,
you know, they get a president who's not really the president. He kind of snuck in through the back door.
Yeah, exactly.
And he's completely incompetent. But he's, you know, I mean, the guy can't even speak the English language.
Exactly.
You know, and you have this guy going, if I hear him say nuclear one more time, I'm going to cut myself.
Yeah. Well, that and the fact that...
Nuclear.
Yeah, but I read in the news today, which actually is so unbelievable, is the fact that his uncle or his grandfather was actually sort of looked after the finances for Hitler. You know, I mean, this man, you know, was responsible for the founding of Nazism, and he's the president of America.
Well, that's disgusting because you have that, and then you have, you know, the whole, I don't know if you saw that Fahrenheit 9/11 video.
No, it's actually, it came out here this week, so I'm actually going to see it.
You've got to see it. It's horrifying because they were friends and are friends with, you know, Bin Laden's family.
Yeah.
So you've got the president, you know,
it's farcical.
One of the theories now is that the Pentagon was actually bombed.
Yeah.
Not because there was no plane wreckage, which I've been online researching. And the other thing was that
yes.
They say that the whole thing was actually orchestrated by Americans.
No, absolutely. I said that from the beginning.
Yeah, the control by fear thing.
For sure. They needed a reason. He was in trouble, and he was in big trouble. So how do you swing it, you know?
How do you swing attention away from him?
Exactly.
You know, indirectly. But the other thing was that they say that... Yeah, I mean, well, my personal thing is that right now it looks like he might win, and if he does, I don't necessarily know that I still want to be here.
Yeah, that's a scary thing. I mean, the better part of your adult life has been spent in wanting to live that, and now you're in a position you're now in a position where you have that, and you're not sure whether you want it anymore.
Well, I'll either come back to South Africa and do it on the phone, or come back. The thing is, I don't want to be. I don't want to become a citizen or any of that. You know what I mean? It's like
there's talk
of that, and I'm like, no, I really don't know if I want to do that.
Yeah, yeah.
Until I'm entirely comfortable that you know, I mean, I'm our government's cut too.
Sure.
I'm not saying anyone's is great.
No.
You know, when it's the most powerful one in the world being this badly run, and so obviously, no one can see that, or no one, you know, or people just would rather go, he's taking out some Arab bastards.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, I mean, you could compare that to the music industry, couldn't you?
Yeah.
You know, depending on what label you're talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just a different beast, same beast, different outfit, really. But the one has weapons and the other one has, you know, has tunes. So, but it's all about the almighty dollar, you know, either way.
It always has been, man.
Yeah, yeah.
I saw that most clearly in the major labels when I was home because, you know, they weren't interested in any local bands because the international stuff was selling them, you know.
Yeah. Because they made it so. They made that so. I mean, they created that monster themselves because the thing is that if they had any inkling on how to market a band, they would be in a position where, you know, it would be the exact opposite, where the international bands would have to work six times harder to be heard. But they created the monster.
Yeah, I mean, but, you know, the funny thing is, I probably met a couple guys that really were into South African music, and the rest of them were so apathetic about the whole thing that it was just, you know, it was just scary. And the thing is, I mean, if they signed South African bands and they were major labels, they could then get distribution through their major label buddies
all over
the world.
Absolutely. But then you're asking them to do more than their job. Because the thing is, if you think about it in a South African context, any band that has ever made it in this market has had, that has happened because of an international marketing plan that was forwarded to them, you know, from Europe or from the States, and they replicated that to a T, but give it to a label to actually generate from scratch. Can't do it. Don't know how.
It's really sad.
Yeah.
I know there's brilliant bands that are struggling to just get, obviously I don't find out much. I have to go online and it's difficult. A lot of the bands don't have good sites, but if I see the list of bands that are playing at Woodstock, there's got to be 70, 80 bands to pick from.
Yeah, 75 bands.
There's got to be at least, say, out of 70, let's go with a really poor ratio, they said there's five great bands that should be signed, that should be,
Should be in a similar position to, have the right to share the same stage as you.
At least have the opportunity. And if it means that we have to come back and start a label and do it ourselves, and marketing isn't difficult. It's not.
But the thing is that it's the same thing that got you started. It's about passion. And if you don't have passion, you have nothing. And the thing is that, you see that daily. And the thing is, if it's the industry by virtue of what it is and the amount of money that it generates, unfortunately attracts a suspect element, as does politics. But, you're in a position where people are driven by, for different reasons. But the biggest joke of all is that if they were driven by passion, the money would follow. But it's the, if you're driven by money, you can't create passion out of money, so it's but it's an exciting time, if nothing else.
Well, it's definitely cool. Everything's cool, actually.
Yes.
They are, obviously, that's the thing that's so funny, when everyone looks at you and says, I'm pretty cool, it is, but there are things that really piss me off.
And then they
think of you as being ungrateful, but
it's not ungrateful, no.
I'm not to be ungrateful because I'm being treated like shit.
Exactly.
It doesn't matter who you are, what you've achieved. If you feel like you're being treated like shit by somebody, you have the right to be pissed off.
Well, if you don't react, then what are you?
Exactly. Then you become one of their puppets, and you allow them to walk over you.
For sure. But you don't allow your best friends to do that. So why anybody else? Yeah. Well, Shaun, it's been an absolute pleasure chatting to you again.
Okay, thanks,
Dan. And Peter said that he's going to be calling you, I think, at about 10:15 or 10:30. So look out for his call.
Okay, cool.
But thank you so much for your time and good luck in Europe. Eh?
Thanks for yours, man. Yeah, I hope it's going to be cool. It's our first headlining club tour of the UK. But I know everyone's really, really excited.
Yes, I think you're going to be blown away, because I think a lot of people are looking forward to it. A lot of people I know that are going to be there, because the better part of Africa now lives in the United Kingdom. So
London
to be South African. That's right. Well, there are over a million there, so I figure if you can take half of them back in album sales, then your conversation with your label will be a very different one.
That'll be awesome.
Excellent. Listen, take care of yourself.
Thanks, man. You too.
And look forward to seeing you when you next come home.
Cool. Thanks, man.
All right, then.